Welcome back. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Coming up, Dr. Harriet Fraad. I just want to remind everybody, Robert Smigel has said, yes, we're doing our benefit for Diabetic Fury this Saturday night at 9:30 with Robert Smigel, Rick Overton, the genius that is Rick Overton, and of course, Jim Earl and Martha Stewart. To get tickets, go to davidfeldmanshow.com right now and hit the, hit pay-per-view, and it'll take you directly to our Eventbrite page, and you can buy a ticket. I think they start at $10, and then there are various tiers. It's for a good cause, diabetes awareness. We're not raising money for diabetes. And Robert Smigel will be there, which means Donald Trump will be there, and Rudy Giuliani will be there. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, and while you're over there, sign up for my newsletter. Please welcome, and sorry to keep you waiting once again. We're trying to figure this show out. One day we'll figure it out. Dr. Harriet Fraad joins us. And the name of your two podcasts are Capitalism Hits Home.
Yeah.
And it's not just in your head.
That's right.
And I want to talk to you about politics, especially the mayoral race. I have a question for you. And I ask tough questions on this show. And I think you're going to find this, I don't mean to humiliate you, but last week I asked you who you were voting for. And you said the former sanitation commissioner of New York City, who the New York Times has just endorsed. They've just come out and called Catherine Garcia as the candidate who best understands how to get New York back on its feet and has the temperament and the experience to do so. Ms. Garcia has our endorsement in perhaps the most consequential mayoral contest in a generation. Last week I asked you, you said you didn't want Stringer. You wanted Stringer, but he had been Me Too'd out of the running. Mm-hmm. And you said, Garcia. Tell me, I will vote for Garcia.
The reason is, first of all, looking at all the candidates, Yang is a tool of Tusk who defeated the union and the possibility of being an employee at Uber, and also puts in big money to defeat public school education and replace it with charter schools. And Yang is also very eager and fine with allowing the Hasidic Jews to not teach their kids English or math or those other unuseful skills. At any rate, I like Garcia for a couple of reasons. One is she is the head of a union, which is almost all male, and the sanitation workers are not necessarily feminists.
No.
It's not a feminist union.
I don't think so.
But she's honest. She's hardworking.
Especially as a man, I would hate to hear a woman tell me to take out the garbage. So she must have done be pretty good.
She is pretty good. And she's very fair about labor. She's pro-labor. I'm surprised the Times endorsed her. But she's not a corrupt candidate like, let's say, Tali Fahariad and Weinstein, whose husband gave her $8.2 million for her campaign and who's a big Wall Street hedge fund manager, so she'll be great on regulating Wall Street.
Right. She's running for DA?
Yes, for DA, where she'll be really just and really impartial on Wall Street matters, having floated in on a sea of money. Hopefully she won't float in. But Garcia has been a strong labor figure, is trusted by her union, which is not a feminist union and is overwhelmingly male, and has a reputation for getting things done and getting them done well. And that's right. A lot. That's a lot of things to recommend her.
We should point out, I've always been reluctant to talk about New York City politics on this show because we have an international audience. But New York City is a country in
international. It's an international city.
Yes, and it has like 8-9 million people who we know of, and it's where Wall Street is located. You have Cyrus Vance, who is the Manhattan DA, who's trying to lock up the Trump family. He had an opportunity before Trump became president, and he punted. Who are you voting for Manhattan District Attorney? Do you have an endorsement?
Yeah, I have endorsements for all of them, but I forgot who's running. Boylan, I think, is who I'm voting for.
Lindsay Boylan, I think, is running for
something else.
Is she running for Manhattan Borough?
Borough President. Right. I worked it out and I wrote it down, but I forgot it.
I remember the good old days. Remember when Ralph Nader would send you a ballot?
Yes, that was nice.
And he would just fill it out. And my parents would just go, we don't have to read the newspaper. We just
here
need
it
to
is.
Ralph Nader yeah. tells us and to Brad do it.
And it was right. Really, you know, he's yeah. been really, as comptroller, he's been wonderful on affordable housing.
Stringer.
Standing up. This isn't, no, I'm talking about Brad Lander.
Oh, Brad Lander.
Who okay. is running for, what is he? No, he's not comptroller. Is, who is the comptroller? At any rate.
Is it Stringer?
No, Stringer was running for mayor. Oh, you mean the current comptroller?
Anyway.
At any rate, Brad Lander is a very progressive candidate, and there's no person on city council in my running on city council except one, so Porter, who's
right.
not worth voting.
Lindsay Boylan on the show. And she does not suffer fools gladly, as I quickly learned on the show.
And so did Cuomo.
And so did Andrew Cuomo. And she was, I think she was either the first or the second to Me Too Andrew Cuomo, who somehow is still there.
Yeah. Well, I think he's afraid to fire people now. You know, he's in between photo ops where he takes credit for defeating the coronavirus. He doesn't want to mess with any more bad publicity because he's already sort of just peeking out from under the garbage.
Right, right.
Big heap.
I was born in Brooklyn, moved to New Jersey, came back to New York, and in my late teens, I discovered you cannot fight City Hall, and I left because I thought, This is what I thought as a teen, you know, my 22, I said, this town's run by the mob. It's run by the mob or billionaires. I'm leaving. There's no point to paying attention to the politics. Koch was the mayor. He was corrupt. He was making some unholy deal with Wall Street to quote unquote save the city. And I didn't start following New York City politics until I moved back here, and I love de Blasio. So I have two questions. One is, are you going to miss de Blasio? Was he the greatest mayor of your lifetime? And two, can you fight City Hall in New York? Does it,
yeah,
can it change things?
It's so big, and it is harder. You know, I left New York, moved to New Haven, where we had an almost general strike and really had quite a bit of power because it was smaller and you could operate better. But New York is in a hopeful mood. You know, AOC is elected. Progressives and socialists are elected to the city council. We're the coastal city that actually knows we're part of the world. We're not like the middle or the south. And we, you know, I feel very hopeful about New York politics. And also it's a strong labor city. And right. that's very powerful because there's very few, the labor movement is in such crap shape, in part because identity politics doesn't include the identity as a worker.
Right.
You know, an identity as rich and an owner is something Trump claimed proudly. But the pride of, I do an honest job and I'm proud of it. I'm part of the mass of people that keeps this whole place going, which was a big identity in the 30s and even in the 60s. And now one's identity now young people are working on their inner whatevers, and they're trying to solve their problems on a personal level, and they're blaming themselves if they aren't where they want to be, that it's something with their family. And of course, that's a participant. But the whole identity, not as a brown person or a black person or a white person or a lesbian or whatever, all of which are very important parts of an identity, but the worker part dropped out, which is why unions actually participated in dropping that out. But that's what we need now. And it's very exciting to me to see something like Deliveros Unidos, the delivery workers for DoorDash and the others, becoming a powerful union, because they're identifying as people who serve. And ironically enough, they got together because the people who were organizing were giving out food. And they found that most of the people who needed free food were food deliverers.
Amazing.
Who didn't have enough to eat.
That's incredible. The people who deliver, it's like an O. Henry story.
It is.
But even more depressing.
Yeah. And
people who deliver our food can't eat.
They can't afford.
Kind of like the doctors and the nurses who can't afford health care.
Right. That's right. Especially the nurses. Doctors get paid handsomely. But, you know, that there are these things going on where people identify as workers, and they now have organizers who speak Creole for the Haitians, who speak Bangladeshi for the Bangladeshi drivers, who are from Honduras, who are from Guatemala, who, you know, and they're coming together in all their different, from all their different little isolated ethnicities. The Chinese are entering to be a powerful union, and they've already gotten concessions. They now can go to the bathroom at the restaurants from which they take the food. They didn't used to be allowed to go to the bathroom.
Amazing.
They now have a right to look at what are the tips that are going in that they never got. And they're now getting more than sometimes $5 an hour.
Right.
So
let me push back on identity politics just for the sake of having a conversation. And, you know, as somebody who has no identity, regardless of how I was born, I'm not a protected class. So I look around and I immediately go to class struggle. I do have conversations with people who are part of a protected class, and they are, many of whom are more protected about their own class than a class struggle for everybody.
Absolutely.
And it's understandable that members of the LGBTQ community would maybe care more about not getting beaten up by cops than they would about unions.
Of course. However, you know, first of all, to define class, which otherwise can be used a thousand ways, for me, class is an economic term. Who creates the wealth? Who gets to appropriate it and decide?
One second. I just want to tell Aaron, can you give me, we're running, can you give me 15 minutes, Aaron Berg? Thank you. Aaron is.
Thank you, Aaron.
He's robbing a liquor store in Schenectady, and we're going to do a live coverage of it. Very exciting.
Well, thank you, Aaron. Yes. At any rate, you know, class relates to an economic thing. Who produces the wealth? Who gets to appropriate it and distribute it as she, he, they want? Okay.
Right.
So that means that if you're in a factory, no one pays you for the exact worth that you produce for them, because then they'd be a bad business person. The idea in business is you pay them less, you get more for you. Not a very nice idea, but that's capitalism, okay? So being a lesbian wouldn't be a class. It would be what you do. Maybe you're in a lesbian relationship and you're in a feudal class relationship with your lesbian lover because you do all the housework, produce the food, produce the cleanliness, and she appropriates it when she gets home. That would be a feudal class relationship.
And it's not and making
invites her friends
so
over
to TV.
That's a feudal class relationship in the household. In the workplace, you can be in a capitalist relationship. Or if it's a co-op, a communal or communist relationship. But I think you can identify as a woman and really have an enormous amount of power knowing that that identity which you bore inside yourself as a mark of inferiority and deference to men is not necessary, not useful, and you're going to reject it. There's a huge power in that. Those people who found who the society deemed to be less and should be servers of others, decide, we're just as good as you, and we have power. That's a heady and marvelous thing, and it has its place. And there should be a class-based movement for empowering those people who do the labor and not those people who appropriate the proceeds because they own stocks on which they pay no taxes because they have a like Warren Buffett didn't, and Trump and Bezos and, Elon Musk, all these people, because they have the money to pay for the sophisticated lawyers and corporate accountants and so on to evade the taxes, and who can pay the campaign fees of those people who they want to run to protect their protected position. That's a different class. But if we had not only an identity as Black or brown or Hispanic or lesbian or female or whatever, but we also knew we were workers together, it would be an identity that doesn't split us apart, an identity in which we'd have a mass to fight for it, so that your workers' movement would fight for the right for workers to have the sexual preferences that they want and fight for the right for women to be equal to men with no glass ceilings, and fight for the right for Black people to be treated completely as equals or given a benefit of the doubt if there's something that's almost because of the historic deficits. Okay, but then that person could look at the Black Lives Matter movement and say, I am Black and I don't want to be seeing myself or be seen as inferior. And then they also might say, ever since slavery, it was very profitable, A, to enslave us and make money off our labor. And then after slavery fell, to make money off our labor. And for the capitalists at the top to separate us so that the working class doesn't unite. And also to have a group that's a kind of safety valve who gets fired first and hired last. And they assume it's because we're lazy or we're not industrious. So it's very handy, and give those insecure white people something to feel good about because they're not Black. Okay. Then you would have a class-based movement that honors everything that creates arbitrary barriers between people while saying that the wealth that we produce belongs to us and ought to be shared. That would be my dream. Because then you'd have everybody fighting for LGBTQ XYZ rights of all kinds. You'd have everyone fighting that all lives matter, including Black lives matter, and cops should not feel that they should arrest more people because right. they're Blacks, as came out today. The New York police were instructed to arrest, get more arrests, fill their quotas, particularly of Black and brown people. Okay. You'd have the mass of people who do the work to keep this place running, championing your cause. And so you would have your own awareness and your own group, but you know you were in solidarity with a mass of people, which means you can win.
Right.
Otherwise, there's room for a few at the top. The Obamas are more than equal. Their kids can go to the same fancy school as Biden's grandchildren and so on. Costs $43,000 a year, even in kindergarten. okay, but that blacks have actually done worse under Obama economically. Well, and then you have everybody.
$43,000 to send your idiot kid to kindergarten? What, do they dip their boogers in gold before they eat them? I mean, what are they learning at 43? That is obscene. That should be against the law.
It's 53 in some of the exclusive schools in New York.
For kindergarten.
Yes, for Dalton, for kindergarten, it's 53 grand. And that's because you get your kid in kindergarten because they may be a little dumb and never get in later where there's an exam. Okay? And you get an edge. And also, you get to meet the
parents. Say that again, please. Say that again, because I was talking to a special ed teacher about the scam that is New York City private schools and how they say, we will take care of, there are some schools, private schools, $50,000 a year. We'll take anybody. I'm sorry?
53.
And then they take money from the Department of Education. They take money from the state of New York, these private schools, which charge $53,000. And
if your kid,
I'm sorry?
That's right. They take public money too. They take the money from the public schools. And they're always fundraising, these schools. In a school like Dalton, as soon as your kid gets in, they start hitting you up for more money and more money and more money.
This is what they do. And then I want to ask you a question about the scam that is private schools. If you're a rich person, you go to these private schools in New York and they say, we will take your kid. He has a learning problem. Write the check for $53,000 and we will educate your child. They couldn't care less about your kid with a learning disability. They immediately go to Albany, the capital, to the Department of Education and hire outside teachers who are paid by the state of New York to come to your kid's private school
right.
and teach your kid.
They passed it. They paid the legislators. They paid them off in the best democracy that money can buy. They bought it. And their kids, like at St. Anne's or at, at Dalton, they have very small classes. They do learn better. In a class of 8 students with 1 teacher, you get a better chance. Plus they have, while some of the kids are learning, let's say math, the other kids are at robotics class, or they may be at gym, which includes things like fencing, which you'd never have in a public school. And that they are so enriched in their, they have programs on their vacations, like going to the Andes and studying the ecology, for which the parents pay. But I mean, you do get an edge over other students because you do get personal attention.
Unless you have a learning disability, in which case.
Then you get a public school teacher to come and tutor you.
And right. So you get a great education. So how come all their kids are idiots? Every one of them turns out to be an idiot.
Well, they're not all idiots.
Yes, they are. They're all idiots. They're all weak. They have no work ethic and they're not closers. They don't close. Well, you hire them and they can't finish the job because they have a destination wedding to get to.
Well, many of them are that way. But also they don't understand what it's like to be a human being in this society.
So they're worthless. They are of no value.
They are of very little value. Look, some of them turn out to be committed, interesting people.
But they don't finish the job. But they can't finish the job. They realize that they were born with a silver spoon in their mouth and they were born on third base. And they realize, no, I didn't hit a triple. I was born on third base. I'm going to dedicate the rest of my life to helping the least among us, but because they're born to so much wealth, they can't finish the job and they fall prey to charlatans like the Clintons.
Some of them really do. There's an occasion. Look, no, nothing is always.
I don't believe
in absolutes.
I do. Name one child of the wealthy.
Okay, I will name one. I don't think this person is a radical. I wouldn't vote for him. but I know that he works hard and has integrity. That's Sean Donovan, whose father gave $1 million for his campaign. He actually is honest and hardworking, but he stays within a capitalist frame, which is a doomed frame for justice in my eyes. Some of them work hard. There's exceptions to every rule. People
they're not closers. They're not closers. They do not. Their heart and their brain, it's just not 100% the way.
Well, what they lack is the deep experiential knowledge of the struggle to live and an appreciation for that in their policies and in their lives. You know, some of those people are principled, decent people. They're real exceptions. But absolute. You know, I'm not religious. I don't believe in absolutes. However, it's not conducive to making a decent human being who has compassion for and a vision of what life is like for the people around him, her, or them.
I would tell, you know, I'm a little older than most people. And I will tell you this, and it's axiomatic, and I don't mean to be rude to anybody, but if you're in a position of hiring and you have the choice between somebody who went to Harvard or a state university, if you have the choice between the child of a wealthy parent or the child of a poor parent, you always go with the child of the poor parent because the child of the rich parent has no work ethic. Doesn't know what it means to have your back against the wall and say, I better go the extra step because rent is due. Do not hire the children of the rich. They are worthless.
Well, I think that's an absolute wrong position. Look, Fidel Castro was a child of the rich.
He failed.
Oh, come on. He made a revolution along with Che Guevara, another child of privilege whose parents put him through medical schools. There are no absolutes. I don't believe in absolutes. I think that there can be exceptions, but it's not conducive to any kind of deep humanity or commitment. It isn't. And I think it separates you from the rest of humanity. I think mental health is connection. And I think those people are to be feared.
You know more about this than I do. And I'm just having fun. But Fidel Castro, he thought he was better than the people he was governing because he was born to
who gave his speeches to the people of Cuba. I remember the one about Israel and the Palestinians saying there are no good guys here. However, within the choice of, you know, bigoted, religion-infested people, but whose land it is, who have a sense of justice, and settler colonialists, you have to choose the people from whom the land is stolen. And it's like Bertolt Brecht said. They said, where do you want to live after World War II? Because he was offered a theater in East Berlin and all the money to run it for his plays and stuff, as well as one in West Berlin. And he said, I choose East Berlin. If you have a certain amount of life serum left and you are a physician, he said, I am a physician. I have a certain amount of life serum. I have two patients. One is a syphilitic young prostitute and the other is a dying old man. So I choose the pregnant syphilitic prostitute. The East Germans weren't flattered, mind you, but he made his choice. You don't have to say that there's good and evil, there's God and the devil. There are decent people sometimes that emerge, but it's a sick system that separates some kids and gives them a better, more thorough education because their parents happen to have the money. That's disgusting. It's a very bad way of doing it. I think you should have educational parks in New York, which are like beautiful campuses with the latest scientific facilities and excellent teaching, and bus all the kids in to be together and to get special services and have after school programs. So it's not only rich kids who get dance lessons and piano lessons and fencing lessons and whatever.
There are all these empty skyscrapers. Perfect. You could take one skyscraper and turn it into an international
educational park. You could have all the kids, take them all downtown and have everybody bussed in so that they're all equally bussed in and have decent meals and have top of the line facilities for everyone so that even rich parents would think, ooh, are we missing something if we don't send our kids?
Right. I mean, literally, if you look at that new development on the west side, I forgot
Hudson Yards.
What's it called? Hudson Yards?
Hudson Yards, yeah.
If that were turned into like an education destination.
An educational park. It would be fabulous.
It's so big. One skyscraper could house, 50,000 kids? How many people?
Of course. And then you could have, you know, the most advanced labs and really interesting teachers and, you know, experiments going on and the best of everything for the children. And you could also have a whole social work contingent because kids do less well if their parents are being evicted, you know, right. Obviously. To have social supports that allow kids to focus, like meals, like help for their parents. These are achievable things. They're right. Not even brought up, even though the first idea of educational parks was brought up in the 70s, as I recall.
Wow.
They're not taken up. They're too democratic.
Just the idea of a 70-story building and so if a teacher can't make it, you know, you take the class, they get in the elevator, and anyway.
And you have great substitutes and assistant teachers, because you could have such a wealth of individual attention and possibility if you had a huge, beautiful facilities, everyone bussed in, and all the supports they need. You know, in a school like Dalton, people pay that kind of money for various reasons. One, they want
You said Dalton, where Chester the Molester was the headmaster.
Chester the Molester, that was Barr's father, who first hired Epstein, with whom he probably had something in common. And Epstein then connected with wealthy men and began his fortune. But he was Barr's father.
Right. They called him Chester the Molester.
And then
he was fired
at the same time as Epstein was fired. He wasn't, but he then got a job at another prestigious, this time boarding school.
Right. You're saying that Bill Barr, the Attorney General, had a father whose nickname was Chester the Molester when he ran Dalton because the kids felt he was a little handsy. And this is the same guy who hired Epstein,
even though he had dropped out of college. You're supposed to have a master's degree at that school.
But you get a hands-on education. They were hands-on.
You sure put their hands on, that's for sure.
So you're saying that the reason you pay $53,000 to get your kid into kindergarten at Dalton is, I never heard this before, is because if your kid isn't testing well, if you get them in, they won't find out in kindergarten. Once you're in kindergarten, you're in.
That's right. You're in for the rest of the time. Plus, you want your kid to go to that school because you want to be connected. And you want their connections to get you into a prestigious college so they can be connected. And though I do think those people are dangerous. I mean, on a personal level, when I was 19 and dancing with a company, and coming back in Colorado, I met a guy and we talked about this film about Africa and African dance. And it was a good conversation. We were both interested in that dance. And at the end, he said, I'd like to go out with you. My name is David Rockefeller. And I thought, holy shit, I'd never go out with you. You could kill me and nobody'd do anything about it. So I said, oh, no, thank you. But, you know,
David Rockefeller.
Yeah, and it ended up
from Chase.
He ended up dying. He collected shrunken heads and gave people money. So they were out there shrinking each other's heads for money. And I think that happened to him at the end too, which would be a poetic justice.
Well, if he had married you, you know, you were a shrink. So he would have
shrunk his head very early.
I have a feeling.
But I get in trouble because he's so rich, you know.
I think you would have shrunk something else of his. I don't think he could handle a strong.
No, those people are dangerous. I thought, ooh, dangerous.
You are one of the founding mothers of women's liberation, of second wave feminism. Going back to identity politics, is it fair to say, you didn't touch on it, but I just want to make sure I understand this. If you lead with your identity, if you say, I'm LGBTQ, first and foremost, you cannot say you're a conservative or a member of the right. You have no right to be Jewish, Black, a woman, LGBTQ, and be a Republican or a conservative.
Well, some of them are. There's a log cabin Republicans who are gay Republicans.
But
kind of a contradiction in terms, but...
You can't separate.
Class interest, but some people's class interest overwhelms all the others. And I think that if you had a class-based movement that embraced liberation movements of all kinds and had the solidarity of a mass behind them, but had class identification, I am a member of the working class. I live from what I earn. I don't live off other people's labor. And I don't want to be an owner either. In the ancient times, it was slave and pharaoh, or slave and master. Then it was serf and lord. Then it's capitalist and worker, owner, employer and employee. That's the class division. But if in addition to that identification as a member of a working class, creating the wealth of your whole nation, within that can be, I am an LGBTQ member of the working class. I am a Black member. I am a brown member. I am a female member. And I have to be treated with utmost respect because I am a human. And I need all of your support, and you better support me in return. Then we would win. We wouldn't be atomized into all these different groups that assume that the enemy is the other one.
Right, right. Well, this was a very valuable conversation. I love talking to you, and I learned that I'm voting for Catherine Garcia for mayor. Do you have my permission? Do I have your
Absolutely.
Permission?
Absolutely, you have my enthusiastic endorsement for that idea.
As the New York Times says.
Yeah, it's too bad to be in their same boat, but okay, yeah. I'd still vote for her. It's like I saw Tali Farhadi and Weinstein, the one with the $8.2 million from her husband, was endorsed by Hillary Clinton. If I hadn't known about her corruption from her husband, just the endorsement by Hillary Clinton, she'd be out.
Right, right. All right.
Okay.
I was going to ask you about Wiener and BDSM and whether or not it's okay to make fun of a 26-year-old Orthodox Jew who's running for, I think, Manhattan Bureau President. And he's into bondage, and there are clothespins on his nipples. And was raised in an Orthodox family. Are we allowed to make jokes about BDSM, or is that?
I think we can. I think we can. Whatever, we can make jokes about anything and everything. And anyone who doesn't have a sense of humor about themselves, forget it. We all can make jokes about ourselves and everybody else.
Well, wait a second. If you're into BDSM and I hurt your feelings with a joke, you should pay me.
Not really. We all get our feelings hurt, you know?
Yeah. So what? He's obviously.
You can laugh at yourself if you're a BDSM fan. You can laugh at yourself.
Do we know what doctors think of BDSM? You know, up until 1971, homosexuality was considered
perversion. It was in the Diagnostic Statistical Manual as a mental disorder.
What is BDSM?
The Diagnostic Statistical Manual that is used to diagnose all psychological illness.
No, the BDSM.
Bondage, and domination, submissive and masochism, I think it is.
And but is that considered?
It's not considered to be one of the disorders. For me, I mean, I've had clients who are BDSM people. There's a certain amount of control that a masochist gets thinking I can take this and the other person is weak, so I let them do that. And they always, and all of them have been in abusive relationships as children. And one of the things that they do for each other is they do have safeties. They do have safety words where the other person has to stop.
Right.
But I don't, you know, whatever people want to do in their bedroom, they shouldn't, you know, physically harm each other. But, you know, I don't give a damn, really.
Unless they're Republicans. Unless you're a conservative, then it's all safe.
Then they have to be locked in their bedrooms and they have to stay there.
Right. This was great. Thank you, Dr. Harriet Fraad. So much fun. So much fun. Your two podcasts are It's Not Just in Your Head and Capitalism.
Max Golding, which I do with Max Golding, and Capitalism Hits Home, which I do by myself.
How do people reach you?
They could go to my website, harrietfraad.com. They could reach me through either program, Capitalism Hits Home, or It's Not Just in Your Head. Or they could send me an email, but whatever. I'll always respond to them.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Harriet Fraad.